So this object-oriented approach so it has one of the reasons for doing this, which we've already seen, is that you have this notion of an abstract data type, okay, and you have this ideally you have a public interface and you have a private internal implementation, which you should not need to know about and you should not exploit, even if you do know about it, because that could be something which disrupts your code if somebody changes the implementation for whatever reason. It could be for efficiency reasons or some other aspect, okay. But the other side, so this in programming language jargon, this whole thing, okay, is called encapsulation, for obvious reasons. So basically you are taking some functional behavior of some object. So you have some kind of representation of some data on which you can do some manipulations, and you want to kind of combine it together into one single piece such that along with the data these functions are associated with it in such a way that they manipulate the internal representation suitably, right? And you should not look inside. So the other part which is kind of related to this is something where you can reuse a data type, meaning that if you already have some information which has been coded or implemented and you want to add some functionality to it or add some extra properties, you don't have to rewrite the whole thing again. You can say use that and then do something more. So that is what this inheritance is, right? So you kind of, the aim here is to set up a so you could have class 1 and then something which is below it, which the idea is that class 2 contains everything of class 1 and more, okay. So if I have that picture, okay, then the claim is that class 1, class 2, so now in this object oriented or inheritance world, this such a thing is called a subclass, okay, and this is called a superclass in the same. So the intent is that these represent in some suitably abstract universe the notion of a subset and a superset, right. So to take a concrete example which we might make this clear, which I found it hard to. So supposing class 1 defines all matrices, okay, and this one defines only square matrices, okay. Then for instance there might be an operation which is defined on a square matrix which is not defined in general on a arbitrary rectangular matrix, so say determinant for example, okay. So now the way to think about it is that you have class 1 which is a set of all matrices and class 2 is a specialization, right. So it there are everything which is of type class 2 is of type class 1 but not conversely, right. So hence this subclass. So subclass, I mean if you think of it in a different more naive context, he suggests that it has got some subset of properties. Actually, it doesn't have subset of properties, it has more properties than the other one. Okay, so that's the thing that you have to keep in mind. So a subclass is typically more whatever, described more powerfully or more detailed than the superclass. Okay, and so you've already seen some basic syntax for this, I think, through Sage. So what you do is you say class B A. Right. So what this means is that B is a subclass of A. Now, there is some technicality here, which is, I think, the definition of A must be available. So if it is not in the same Python file, then you have to import it. Right? So supposing A is in some other file, then you have to first import that file in this thing, saying from that file import everything. That makes A available, then you can inherit. Okay? So this is the basic. Now, what happens typically, as I said earlier, is that supposing you had a class matrix, okay, and among the things that it said was defined a kind of object oriented matrix multiplication, multiply this matrix by another matrix. Right? Now, if I write class, say, square matrix inherits from matrix, right? Then supposing I don't do anything. Okay. And I just say def, say suppose this is the only thing I define in square matrix. Okay. Oh, sorry, yeah, self. Right. Should never forget that. Right. So you have a function which, so you've added a new function called determinant. Okay. Then the thing is that if I in my code somewhere I write M is equal to square matrix, right, and say maybe I should use M1, so now when I ask M1 to be multiplied by M2, there is no code in square matrix for this. Right? So the whole idea of this inheritance is that if it is not defined in square matrix, it will go up and look in matrix. Right? So this will automatically, this thing will automatically go and find this function. That's the idea. Okay? So if you don't have that function in the current class, the idea is that you go up to your parent. And then if it's not there, so you can do this at multiple levels, right? So I can't think of anything more than square matrix, but supposing you had two levels, so something is more specialized than square, maybe square identity matrix. So if you have one, then it will have only 0 and 1 on the diagonal. Then it will be, if you take square identity matrix which inherits from square matrix, then square matrix itself inherits from matrix, so this is transitive. So it will inherit everything which is defined in matrix. So you can do multiplication on that. It will go up, look at square matrix, says I don't know how to do square matrix, go up, or you can think of it as my multiplication is the same as my parents' multiplication, and my parents' multiplication is defined in terms of its parent and so on. So it will go up till it finds a definition. If it doesn't find a definition, then of course it will say there's no such function. But there is this idea that you don't have to rewrite that code. That's the main point. Right? Or if you want to uniformly make all matrix multiplication behave in a different way, you only have to change it once. Right? Then all things that inherit from it will also derive a new notion of this.
Can you maybe a new class which inherits requires more initialization than
So this is Yeah, so this is something which I was playing with and I was having trouble. Okay, so there are So let's start with the easy case, okay? Right, so supposing you don't want to use that multiplication, you maybe you want to exploit some other structure or define it in a different way for square matrix. Then if you write the same function with the same name, right, then it will take the nearest one. Okay, so this is the easy case. So now supposing I have I have three classes, so two inherits from, so this is like this. Okay, now supposing I have an f here and I have an f here explicitly defined, and I have no f here, right? So here, can I say I don't want the C2 version, I want the C1 version? If I just say f bind by default, it will go up in the first f it finds it leaves. Okay, so there is a way to navigate. So just like self is a way of referring to yourself. So normally if I take a C3 object, if I say something x is equal to C3 and then I say x dot f, it will say it's not there in C3, it inherits from C2, so it will go and pick C2 dot f. But supposing I don't want it to pick C2 for whatever reason, I wanted to pick C1 dot f at that point, or or somewhere inside the code I wanted to pick. So if I wanted to write a function which used the f from two levels up. Okay, so there is usually a way to navigate up, and this I'm having difficulty with understanding how Python does it, but anyway, the usual way is that there is a, so you can use this let me first erase this. So this is analogous to what we have now, which is that self refers to this object. Okay, so there is a subtle difference, because this object is a concrete, it's an object, right? It is an instance of a class with specific values attached to it. So it is a thing which is sitting in memory with certain attributes assigned certain values, it is an object. Whereas parent is not an object, parent is a concept. Right? Because it is only the functions that are defined there can be used, because you are not saying that this object is a child of that object. You are saying this object inherits the properties of that class. Right? So this is a class, first of all. Okay? But now, just like we say math dot square root, it says in the class math, look for the function square root. Right? Or we say something, so we can generally give the name of the, so that's, you should think of math as being one class definition, and inside math all these functions are defined. Okay, so similarly you should think of, generally the thing is the class name dot the function name describes if there is ambiguity about where it is. It tells you which version, because there is no reason why I can't define a function called square root in some other place, provided I make sure that I know which one I'm calling. Right? If I don't say anything, it is the one that I have. If I say math dot square root, it is the one that comes from math, and so on. So that's the usual way of doing it. Right? So in the normal situation, I can say super dot f explicitly to go up one, and therefore I can say super dot f. I mean, this is not valid Python syntax. This is just conceptually, this is how it should work. Okay, so in a language like Java, this works. Okay. So this is what you want to achieve. So you want to say explicitly, just like you can normally say from math import star, or say, you know, math dot py. If I don't, okay, if I just say import math, then I can say math dot py. Okay, so if I just say import various things, and maybe the same function is available on different ones, I can give the name of the class and the function to make sure it's this one and not that. Okay, so now in the same way, implicitly I am importing C2, which imports C1, right? So therefore, I can now say, instead of giving the name C1, I just say go up one level and give me F, or go up two levels and give me F, with respect to where I am in the class hierarchy. Okay, so super is a kind of it's simultaneously the name of the class, but it's also like an operating object. Like it's saying, give the super class of my class. Right? So it's like a variable, but it's like something which takes a given object and produces a class which is one level above it, and so on. Right? Now the thing in Python is that so the question is, can I write something like the picture that I have in mind is that, assuming that C2 and C3 are not connected to each other, that I have simultaneously I am inheriting things from both C2 and C3. Okay, so now the problem that comes here is that if I have a function which is defined in both my parents but is not defined in my class, then the logic of my earlier thing was take the nearest one. But in what sense should C2 or C3 be nearer than the other one? Because they are both one level above me. Okay? So one way of doing this is to break the tie in order. So first look in C2, then look in C3. Okay? So I can either resolve by searching in order. Right? So I pick up the first definition. Now, one should be careful if you are writing any sensible code. Okay, this must mean that F more or less does the same thing, but maybe doing two different implementations. Like there may be two different versions of multiply matrix, or there may be two, but it cannot be that in one case it does matrix multiplication and the other place gives you some determinant. I mean, that would make no sense, right? So this would only make sense if you have two compatible operations, but there are two different ways of doing it. But the problem is not that you would want to do it, but this can happen. If you allow multiple inheritance, this can happen, and then you have to figure out how to say it. Okay, so I think in the earlier version of Python, some very old version of Python, this was the default. It used to go left to right. But now Python allows the super to be more clever, and it allows you to say go to that class and get it, provided that class is above me or parallel to me, but not independent, right? So I cannot use super and invoke math, but I can use super and invoke C2, I can invoke C3, and apparently, and this is something which I have not tried out, and I don't know why you would do this, but you can also go to super and invoke C4. I mean, it has to be connected either as one of your ancestors in the list of things that you have inherited, right? So if I go to, now I have more than one parent, so I can go to more than one parent, all of their parents and so on. So that is my ancestry, right?
Inherit from your cousins.
Or I could look sideways one level, so what they call sibling. So you must share one parent. So it's not.
Also, maybe you can go up to generation.
So that it doesn't seem to allow. It says sibling. So by sibling, I understand that it must have a one level parent. But anyway, so what, and this is what I'm finding very hard to figure out in Python, what is exactly the syntax. But now the general version of Python seems to say, super, say C3, okay, now this is some, so as far as I can understand, and I'll show you the documentation and you can see whether you can understand it better, okay. Now this makes sense, at least if you forget that C4, see this notion of is an instance is transitive. If I am an instance of C1, I am also an instance of C2 and C3. Okay. But it takes two arguments, and this is something which mystifies me, why it should take two arguments.
This will take F from C3.
It will take F from C3, but why is it not super of C3 dot F? Why does it need this self or something else? Okay. So this I don't understand, but anyway, so this is just to show you somewhere. So it always has this one standard example. Okay. So you want to define some function called method in class C, okay, which inherits from class B. Okay. So now, okay, so now it's a super of C. Okay.
But you pass self.
So maybe I should. So this whole I'm not able to understand the syntax. I mean, I try to do an I'll do an example, and then maybe we can iteratively figure it out. So if I understand this syntax correctly, I should say this. Self is an object of C1. So I just don't, I mean, there's not enough documentation in the official documentation, and I can't find any other good documentation of this at all. Okay, so if in C, no, how does this doesn't make sense. It must be C3 only, sorry. No, so let me go back to, I should not have done all this. Let me see if I can get a couple.
So you are passing self to C.
So this is what it's supposed to say. Okay, now it's not very clear, but it says, I go down this. Okay, so it returns see parent or sibling class of type. First of all, it says, okay, but it doesn't say anything about the second argument, which is optional.
It says that the second argument is omitted if super object return is unpowered.
Yeah, and the second argument is obviously the instance of object type must be true. An instance of the second argument is type, then is subclass type must be true.
So you can say both object and type.
Object or type. Okay. So anyway, so I was trying to, so I found somewhere another example,
so
and let's. Yeah, we should be able to skip the self. Anyway, so let's do this example and see if we can make it work. Okay, so here is an example which I found somewhere. Which is actually a version of the example that we had. Okay. So supposing I want to define what we did last time, or what we have been doing, which is point. And then I want to define two subcases of point, okay. One which I will call E point and M point, and I'll explain why. E and M is for simplifying my writing, but the idea is that this is distinguished by how distance is interpreted. So I will have different distance functions. So E point will take the usual square root of x, delta x squared plus delta y squared, whereas M point will take absolute value of delta x plus absolute value of delta y. It will just be the Manhattan distance, the coordinate wise difference added up. Right. So I started doing this and then I was getting stuck. Okay. So I started with our favorite point. Okay. So I defined that init as before with optional arguments. Set point, get point is our old friend. Okay. So this was the wrong set point. Okay. Well, I don't have to. Because it just updates you. It's one of those things which, whereas get point actually returns a pair of coordinates to you, and distance does nothing. Okay, so the distance, so point has no notion of distance. I just put a dummy thing there, okay, to know that I'm inside point, but this function doesn't do anything. Right, now I wanted to take this definition. Okay, so this is in a file called basic point.py, which you can't see. It's down there. Okay, so I take now this definition and define my Euclidean point. Okay. So for the moment, I'll come back to this in a minute. I'm trying to just use init again. I'm not trying to use the init of point. Okay, but I'm saying I'm inheriting from point, so that means I will get set point and get point. I will get from there, hopefully. Okay. And now let me skip this super business for the moment. Okay, so this is what my basic intention is, that I have a
init will be different for each class.
Yeah, so I would ideally like to have init to copy that init, but I'm trying to figure out how to do it. Okay, so this is my E point, right? So all I've done is I have first unnecessarily, I believe, okay, but I don't know how to fix this yet, I have rewritten init. But the other part is I have only written one new function, which is distance, which is different from the earlier one. Okay. And similarly, so this is what I wanted to do, but it doesn't work. So here I just say the absolute value of the x difference plus the absolute value of the y difference is the So this much should work, and I believe it will work. So if I say so maybe I'll just put it all in one file because it becomes a bit confusing other. Okay, so I have one single import of math, then I have the definition of point, okay, with a distance function, then I have a definition of endpoint which calls point, but point is defined in the same file, so I don't have to call it from anywhere else, okay, and then I have e point. So that is just that when I exec the file, I want all these classes to be available in one shot. Right? Is this clear? So I have all three classes. So I have this point, and below it I have two parallel things, one is called endpoint, one is called e point, both of which inherit from point. So I believe this works. So remember the default is 0, 0. So if I say p dot distance q, it will call that stupid function which gives me the coordinates of the second thing that I asked for. Okay. But if I had said p is equal to e point 3, 4. Okay, so yeah, so q can actually be the same. Okay. Yeah, so that's Euclidean, right? Because it's square root of 9 plus 16, and if I now say p is m point, then I should get 7. Okay. So this is how it works, right? So it automatically, based on that, it picks up the correct definition distance. So it ignores the upper one because it is there. But at the same time, though p is an m point, I can apply functions like getPoint because they are defined in the superclass point. So though there is no definition in ePoint or mPoint of this function getPoint, it will go up automatically and get it. Okay. So this part is fairly clear. Now it's the super business which I can't get right. So now supposing I want this to just go up there, so I believe this should work. I mean, I'm just going by the syntax of this super thing. So it needs a type, and it'll go there, and it'll execute that.
So you're kind of just calling that.
Yeah, I would get it anyway for free if I just don't define distance. But I'm saying this distance
it's
calls
distance.
It. Yeah. Yeah. So I hope, but I was trying it and it was doing some funny business. So let's try. So now, unfortunately. But it shouldn't, no? Why is this?
Why is it the e point or not?
No, did I save that?
E point.
Oh, e point. Let me just change both GSP so. So now I don't know what it means to be a type but not a class object. See, because if you look at the
point is a class object.
Yeah, but the definition doesn't use point, right? It uses, yeah, point is a class, that's true. But I don't know in this case what it means by, because I'm just going by the fact that here when they do the example, when they do the example, they just call it with the name of a class.
But what is type of key if it's
type of?
Key.
Yeah. It's instance. So you have this function, by the way, like is, right? You have this instance. I think is not instance or is instance. Cha. No, no, no. There is some.
Is underscore.
Is underscore instance? You think? Off or no off?
No, I think it's is instance.
Oh, like this.
P dot is instance point. It's a method of P.
I can find it 1 second if I just go to the top of this. Is instance is one word, but I think, yeah, okay, I was kind of between us, we were.
Is instance point comma p
object,
okay. Or p comma
int. Oh, okay, that, okay. Okay,
yeah.
Finally got it right. Right, so is instance is transitive. So we defined it as an e point, so it's also an instance of m point. I mean of point, but not of m point, because m point is sideways. Right? And the other thing you can do is subclass. So you can say so you can check whether something is a subclass or something else. So you can do some, so in Python basically you can do some, your programming, your code can actually do some inquiry about what's happening in the, whether the types are correct or not before you invoke something. So that is something which is kind of quite powerful, because you can examine the type of an object before you decide to proceed on that. But the super thing is a bit mysterious to me, so I have not yet figured out what is the correct way to do this super thing. So I think I got this far. So now I am just putting an object along with it. But anyway, the other issue which I had with this was that it seems that therefore it's also hard to, so I would ideally like to not do init. Now I don't know if that happens automatically or not, so that's something to try out. If I don't do an init here, does it automatically run the init on the top, right? So supposing I I don't define. Okay, so if I just comment out this init and endpoint. So now what I would like to know is okay, so I can now again check, so all this stuff is there, right? So this has been imported properly. Now if I say p is equal to m 0.3,4. So like this init, if it doesn't find it here, it will go up and use that init. Okay. So if you just want to reuse the init, that's okay. So that's also good, because then you don't have to construct this thing again. You only need to supply the extra functions. Okay. But now the sometimes what you want to do is you want to take the parent class and then add some. So this is a case where we're only adding attributes to it. Right? But sometimes you want to do something where you also add, I mean, we have only added functions, but you might want to add some extra attributes to it. So you might want to have, I don't know, some point which not just has xy coordinate, but it has some other value. Say it has a name. Okay, so you would like to initialize the name in this part, but use the upper one for the xy part. You would like to say, do whatever my parent does with the first two arguments, and set up a point with two coordinates, but in addition set up self dot name equal to p. Right? Now there you have to explicitly write an init here which will call the init above, because it's not enough to just by default call the init above, because the init above doesn't know what to do with the third argument. And then in such a situation you will have to use this super thing saying child comma self.
The word child is the name of the child class.
Okay.
And comma self.
Yeah. So that works.
I don't know. I found that.
Yeah. I mean, I tried that and it was not. So let me. Supposing, so what I'm saying here is that I want to call super.
Oh.
Yeah, this is what I mean. I just don't understand.
Must be type, not.
No. So first of all, so this is what I would like to say.
Yeah, exactly. That's what.
Supposing now I have in an endpoint I provide three arguments. Where the first one is now some string which is the name of the point, and A and B should be the coordinates which default to 0. Then I would like to say, okay, use my point thing to set self dot x, self dot y, okay, and then use self dot name separately. So now the problem at this stage is, it's as with all these things, is a bit existential. At this point, what is init doing? Init is setting up this object. Now all this documentation for super suggests that the second argument to object must be, if it is an object, must be a object of the first type. Now at this point when init is executing, does this object exist or not? See, init is the setting up of this object. So it's like saying that I am in the process of creating this object, and in the process of creating this object I am going to use the constructor, this init function from the upper object. So at this point when I am in the process of creating the object, does this object exist or not? Right? And if it doesn't exist, then it doesn't make sense to say that self is a instance of endpoint, because it is not yet created. And if it cannot be done, then I believe you cannot call init this way. So I'm just a bit mystified by the Python documentation for self and how, I mean for super, and how it is supposed to be used. But the intention is very straightforward. It's a complication which comes out of this this desire to have this multiple inheritance. So multiple inheritance is generally a good thing if you want to combine two features of two different classes, right? So I mean, supposing you have some attribute called color, okay, and supposing you have a function which displays colors, then if you inherit, you want colored points, then you might inherit point which gives you the coordinates, and you might inherit from a class called color which allows you to set a color value to it, and then depending on which you want, what part you want to do, if you want to manipulate the coordinates, you use functions from point. If you want to display the color, you want to put a dot on the screen, and you want to set the pixel RGB value, you use that. So that is typically the reason why you want multiple things to be inherited. So
I think here what will work is,
yeah,
what? I was working on my computer.
Yeah.
You say instead of saying super point dot self, you just say point dot underscore underscore init underscore underscore
a. Yeah.
But that's not good in the sense.
Yeah. So that is like using the exploiting the fact that you can call any function of any class because there is no privacy.
Right.
Ideally, you would like to be able to restrict yourself to calling super, and in a actually in a private world. Right. In principle, the reason to do this is that you can actually inherit from a class which is predefined in Python, whose implementation you don't know anything about. So you may not have any idea how, if say Sage uses matrices, you may not have any idea how Sage actually internally implements a matrix. And you want to take this matrix and you want to extend it, but you don't know how to set it up because you want to exploit all the functions that Sage has for matrices without knowing what Sage does. So the only way you can do it is to allow Sage to set it up, right? So you have to rely on this in this default underscore init of the parent class because you don't know what it does, but you know that having done that, certain functions become available to you, right? And then maybe in terms of what it allows you to do, you can define more functions. So if you have no idea about the implementation, then the only way you can get the subclass to have the same structure is to implicitly call the superclass's init function. Otherwise, you might be setting it up in a way where the superclass cannot operate on it. Right? So this is crucial in some sense. The fact that it's not just a convenience that you are allowed to reuse the init, but it's almost sometimes crucial that the init should be the same init as the parent does, because you don't know what that init does. Okay? So similarly here, I mean, if we are not able to get, if we didn't want to use p.x and self.x explicitly, if we just knew that the point type allows us to get the x and y coordinates using get point, right? So then I could still write this distance function even if my init puts it in r theta, because I will set up the point, I will provide it an x, y, I will say init, that thing will set up r theta. When I want to do distance, I will say, okay, get me back my x, y, and then proceed. Okay, so that is usually the way in which you interact with these things, because the whole idea is that this is like a accumulation of work. So people have defined classes to do various things, and now you find that there is a class which does almost what you want, but there are a few extra things that you want to do. So you derive from that. So you inherit that class and you extend it. But when you inherit that class, you don't want to burden yourself with how everything inside was done. You know that in terms of what you can do with that class, you can do more things, right? So therefore, having to set up the object and all that should not be left to you. It should be something, because then if somebody changes the internal implementation of that class, your inheritance should not fail. Just as if you are just reusing somebody else's class by saying p equal to point, there's no fundamental difference between saying p is equal to point and my point inherits from point. In both cases, I'm using the fact that there is an object which somebody has defined, some class somebody has defined with a public and private part, and I want to only stick to the public part. So it is not quite the same as what we discussed in the last class, which is that if I'm inside point and I change, if I define distance, I'm allowed to look at xy because I know that I'm using xy and this is defined in the same class. So if I update xy to r theta, then I'll know that I am the one maintaining the code. Both functions are written by me. Whereas if it is a subclass of something, that code is not written by me. The top upper class was written by somebody else. So I should not exploit that. Okay. Now Python doesn't distinguish between these, unfortunately, because nothing is explicitly tagged as private. So it does allow, like Amritanshu said, you can just give the name point underscore underscore init, right, and pass it two arguments. But that's not quite the spirit of what super underscore underscore init is. So super says, I know that there is a parent of mine which works this way, and therefore I am exploiting that. Whereas point could be anywhere. It need not be my parent, could be some other class somewhere else, completely unconnected with what I am doing. So there is a bit of mystery. I'll try to see if by Wednesday, I thought it was straightforward, and then only when I started coding it on the bus coming here, I realized it doesn't work. Okay, and I can't figure out why it doesn't work or how it should work. So we'll wind up this.